Thomas Hobbes is the founder of the modern contractarian view of ethics. He is writing in the post-Reformation era, so he would be writing at least 100 years before the U.S. was independent, but he would have been alive when the first settlement of the U.S. was around. So Thomas Hobbes, he lived in a very dark period in England where there was a terrible civil war, and he had seen firsthand what it's like to have a government that cannot enforce its rules, where there's so much chaos and to some extent anarchy, because you have several different powers competing for which one is going to be the main power in the area. Hobbes is able to use this picture as kind of a launching point to describe ethics without a government. We had done this earlier in the semester when we asked whether ethics could be distinct from the law. And we imagined somebody who lives in the world without any government, any law, anything legal or not. We could ask the question, is there still morality? Hobbes himself specifically created this scenario famously in order to ask this question rigorously. He imagined a state of nature. The state of nature is a situation in which there is no government, no structure, no society. It is just the natural world with some animals and individuals in it. So the state of nature has each individual without a setup with cooperation, without communities, without all these other different like conventions and social customs. It's just a void of all that. So you can just imagine just a forest area and just the world is out there. It's ready to be, you know, used and cultivated and people can just inhabit it and continue to try to flourish. In this state of nature, we want to ask, is ethics still there? If it's still there, then ethics is more fundamental than the law. But Hobbes wants to talk about an intermediate position, one that doesn't have a government but still has individuals, more than one individual. So it isn't just an individual on an island just by themselves. And we want to ask, if there is more than one human in the state of nature, is there still ethics? So suppose you're in this state of nature. You're just a lonely dude, and you just are trying to get by. You're trying to enjoy life, and you find yourself a little rock that you can sit on so you can fish. Suppose you're out in the world and you do this. You're relying on natural resources. You're not taking more than nature can afford you. But notice that in this world, in this situation, there's a lot of things lacking. You don't have trade, you don't have education, you don't have a ton of different things that you rely on in order to have a good life. There's no bakeries that you can buy bread. There's a lot lacking in this society. Even though you have the ability to fish, or maybe perhaps you can go forage for berries, there's a problem. And the problem is that you are in constant anxiety. Why are you in constant anxiety? Because not only do you have limited resources for you to go live, there are also other individuals you might come across. And if those individuals are competing for the same resources, and they're being self-interested, then you are a threat to their well-being. Hobbes calls this a war against one another, and that life in the state of nature would be nasty, brutish, and short. It'd be solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. And the reason for this is that at any moment, everything could be taken from you. Your comfortable spot where you fish where you like to sit, somebody can come by and kill you. There's nothing preventing them from killing you. In fact, they would be much better off if you were not fishing and taking fish that they could be getting. In fact, they might like your spot and your fishing pole tool, and they might like to get fish themselves. They don't want to do the work. They would rather benefit from what you have done. So it would be in their interest to get rid of you and take your resources. Now, if that's true, suppose that two people are competing for resources and it would be better for the other person not to be around, not to be alive, then you've got a problem. What's the problem? The problem is it's in your interest to also kill the other individual, especially if you're worried about the fact that they could threaten you and your life, your livelihood, and your health. Hobbes wants to say at the very outset, everyone would be rational to do the following, to take every advantage he possibly can of securing his life and health. And if offered peace, it would be always rational to accept peace. So imagine this situation. Suppose you find another individual and you don't know whether they're going to kill you or not. It's in your interest, perhaps, to have the preemptive strike, to go make sure that person doesn't kill you. Because why? In the state of nature, everyone's equal. Anybody can be killed. Everyone is under anxiety of death. If somebody sees that you're alive and you are stronger, they might wait for you to go to sleep and then kill you. Anybody can get killed. Somebody who's stronger, who's smarter, someone can always find some way to kill the other individual. This is like super gruesome and dark, but the idea here is that it is in your advantage to make sure that you do everything in your power, if you're self-interested, to make sure that you get rid of threats. So suppose someone comes at you and threatens you, and you, whether you make a preemptive strike or not, you defend yourself, you defend your life, and you have the option of killing them. One thing you could do is make an agreement. You could make an agreement and say, if you don't kill me, if you stop pursuing me, but instead pledge your loyalty to me, I will spare your life. It'd be rational for that person to accept your offer of peace. It'd be acceptable to say, hey, I want to be alive. I don't want to get killed. I will accept this offer. I'll just be faithful to him. Now, if you're making that offer and he accepts your offer or your covenant or your contract that he will be faithful to you and you will not kill him, then you have already started to cooperate. You've created a social contract or a set of rules for social cooperation. Now, suppose you are working together and you see yet another individual out there, and that individual continues to walk by the sidelines. You might say to your now faithful person who has covenanted with you or made a contract with you, hey, we're stronger together against this individual. It'd be in your interest to go make that person pledge fidelity, faithfulness to you, and continue to amass strength so that if there's any other individuals out there, you'll be stronger to face them. And this process can keep happening over and over and over until you have a gang, until you have a tribe, until you have a society. That is the core idea here, is that it would always, at each step, be rational to accept the offer of peace if it means allowing you to live when greater harmony and in greater prospects of living in peace. It would be rational for you, and out of self-interest, to accept the terms laid out for you. Unfortunately, at every point, there is going to be the prospect that if you don't, that you could be killed. It's always to your interest then to accept these offers, but it comes at a cost of conflict in the first place. But that conflict must inevitably happen. That context must inevitably occur. This is why the whole point behind Hobbes' State of Nature is to emphasize, like the prisoner's dilemma, it'd be better if you cooperate. Let's set up a structure for creating a cooperative context. Now, you might be asking, what on earth makes sure that these individuals who have made this covenant, who have made this contract, to obey what they've agreed to? That they won't, after accepting the offer of peace, that they won't just go to sleep and wait until dark, until the person who made the offer of peace goes to sleep, that you could just go kill him. And then you're no longer under his thumb, you're no longer under his influence. That's a great question. What prevents you from breaching your contract? Hobbes wants to say, we need an individual who enforces these contracts, an individual who can, or a power or a sovereign that can make sure that people are faithful to what they've agreed to or covenanted to do. This is the idea where you would have a government or governor kind of stand on top and make sure everybody stays in line. This would be a gang leader who makes sure that all the others live in fear if they were to go against the demands of the gang, the demands of the agreement. Hey, if you're faithful to me, I'll be good to you. But if you break contract, if you no longer pledge your fidelity to me, we're going to lay the hammer. And this individual, if the person has power and enough support, can always make sure that all of these underlings will be able to stay in line. That's the core idea here. So the question is, how can we be rational in this context? What would be rational is to obey the sovereign and secure peace. Obey the sovereign and live in the benefit of knowing that you have greater security under their care than out by yourself. This context is the basis for social contract theory. The idea that it would be better to live under a power that enforces rules, limits our freedoms, but gives us greater ability to enjoy a long, prosperous life. So what kind of rules would we accept? Well, I gave originally, like, hey, if you pledge fidelity to me, like, I'll save your life, I won't kill you. That sounds like a rule that you could accept, but what if you can continue to refine those rules to be more fair, to be more rational, to be more treating each individual in the society as equals? That is what we're going for with social contract theory.